Right. Well, good morning, everybody. It's got to about 10:02, I think. So I think we should start. I'm expecting quite a lot more people, at least another 10 or 12 people to join as we carry on this morning. Welcome to everybody, and thank you for joining us this morning. If you could keep yourself on mute whilst you're not speaking, usual rules of Teams Zoom meetings apply. If you want to ask a question as we go through the presentation, if you can flag that through the chat function, that would also be great. We are due to have an APPG AGM this morning, but I'm going to wait, probably do that at the end. There's not much to do on that, and I need a couple more colleagues to be on the call before we can do that. But the main meeting this morning is, you know, clearly everybody knows, as you've seen from, you know, the not least from the government's communications, that Christmas is regarded as critical for everybody, but particularly for the high street, as businesses try to recover from the last couple of years and successive lockdowns. The latest set of public health challenges, including some really quite extreme measures, which I think the House of Commons are expecting to be stepped down quite quickly. The pressure to have to self-isolate for 10 days if you've just been in contact with someone else is causing quite a lot of consternation amongst colleagues. And although people were reluctant, I think, to vote against what seemed to be otherwise sensible health measures on Tuesday night, there is quite a lot of concern about that. So I'm going to open the main meeting today by explaining to you all, as I have just a moment ago, that Christmas is critical for everybody, particularly critical for the high street, for retail. And I think that what I'm really keen that we're going to have this morning is some really helpful insight from logistics, from retail, from hospitality, and look at some of the challenges. But I'm going to open the meeting by asking OJ to say a few words to us. Good morning.
Thanks a lot, Stephen. So OJ McDonald, CEO of the Association of Town and City Management. So as Stephen's just explained, Christmas is a pretty vital period for our high streets. And we approach this period with a number of challenges that seem to be all happening, converging at the same time, creating challenges around the supply of actual products in certain stores, amongst multiple product categories, but also a challenge around labour shortages as well. Now, to go into why this particular conversation is so important to the high street is every year, Christmas is a critical period. That's why it's known as being part of the Golden Quarter. That period from October to December is when many of our businesses on our high streets make up what can sometimes be a shortfall for the rest of the year and get some cash in the bank. It's critical. This Christmas is probably the most critical we've ever seen for our high streets because of successive lockdowns, which have really harmed trade over the past 19 months. And then you consider what we go into next year. We look at that gradual phasing out of business rates relief. We look at things like the moratorium of evictions, that tenant-landlord relationship changing next year as well. So there's a number of pressures on our businesses to make sure that they are in a much stronger financial position to ensure that they can survive. They are counting on this Christmas to be a successful one, which puts them in a much stronger position for 2022. The challenges around labour and product shortages are a really critical issue, which we've got to better understand and support with in any way we can. That's before we even go into the circumstances of this uncertain public health territory we seem to be moving back into again. And so that could very well be yet another challenge our high streets have to consider. So it's in that context that we've decided to have this meeting today. So Stephen, that's enough from me.
You, sorry, thank you, OJ, it's great. James, we've got three speakers this morning. And first is James Child, who's the Senior Associate Director at BNP Paribas Real Estate. And I'm going to ask James to say a few words to us now. James, good morning, welcome, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Yeah, good morning, everybody. Thanks for having me. It's as OJ's just touched on, what an awful lot we have to talk about today. One thing, I'm very bad at timekeeping, so if I do go on, then please do just put me on mute or tell me to stop talking.
I'll ring the chairman's bell, James. Don't worry.
Thank you. By way of introduction, I'm currently head of industrial and retail research at BNP Paribas Real Estate. Prior to that, I was at EG, which is formerly known as the States Gazette, the property magazine, for 10 years. So most of my professional career has been involved in data analysis and research. And, you know, as an introductory slot to this session, I think it'd probably be wise of me to just talk over some of the main issues that high streets have faced, as we'll all know, but also what that's meant for the other component of the real estate family, which is the industrial sector, and then the knock-on effect that supply chains have had. So as an analyst, you know, we often compare apples and apples a lot of the time, but obviously with a pandemic, it's very difficult to, you know, compare anything to what's happened over the past 18 months or so. So we go back to the last recession, which is a good line in the sand to see where we can go from. And I think if we take retail as a starter for 10, you know, at that time, long leases were still being signed for, rents were still extremely high. Looking forward to where we are now. USPs for stores, for certain stores, great example being department stores have been completely eroded. And there was this huge, huge spate of development for new retail stock. A lot of that being in out of town areas, which has really, you know, been another hammer blow for town centres as well. So lots of issues coalescing from many years ago that have now led to where we are. And actually, it's a good point to raise that during that period, retail spend online was only around 4 or 5%. We fast forward to pre-pandemic, that's up at 20%. Peaks and troughs up to around 35, 36% during the lockdown periods, obviously, because all the shops were indeed shut. But now we're beginning to see an equilibrium of sorts and a bit of a move into a transitionary period where it looks like it's leveling out, stabilizing at around 25, 26%, which is still, you know, an extraordinary amount. That's a 5% uplift in 18 months, 5 years worth of growth in that period. So there's a huge amount of calibration that's been going on behind the scenes. And a lot of that has been borne out from the logistics sector, as I said. And, you know, a phrase that I end up using quite a lot is the move from store to shed. That's what retailers have been doing. Not just retailers, of course, but the online giants that we all know. And another great component of this huge demand for shed space that we're seeing is from third-party logistics operators. So that would include, you know, your Hermes, your DHLs, and so on. And the logistics sector really is the invisible hand in the components that form our built environment. Man on the street you don't really see these big Goliath sheds unless you perhaps you go on a shed safari and drive down the M1 or the M25, but they are there and they're increasing in order to satiate this demand and our changes of how we consume. But of course there's an irony in this, in the fact that such is the demand for that space in order to mitigate our changes in the way that we spend, that indeed there's a shortage of those sheds. And as you all know, there are problems with supply chains across the board. So we can't get construction materials to build them or the people to do it either. So this probably, you know, leads into the next part of the conversation, which is about the supply chain issue that we have here. There's plenty of polls out at the minute. The most recent one I read yesterday was that 50% of people have experienced shortages in goods in supermarkets. The big driver of this, obviously, no pun intended, is the lack of HGV drivers. Of course, exacerbated by the pandemic, but actually, has been with us for a number of years as a result of the legal regulations with Brexit, in regard to Brexit. Why are people leaving the profession? Poor pay, poor working hours, and indeed, poor working conditions. An interesting stat I saw yesterday with regards to, as I mentioned, I'll almost obsessive retail spend is that if the patterns continue the way they're going, then by 2025, there's going to be a requirement for an additional 38,000 lorries on the road. Now, that comes at a time when we're trying to decrease the amount of vehicles on the road. And of course, that's another conversation for another time. But if you were to line those lorries up along the M1 from London, they would reach Scotland. Gives you an idea of just how much how much freight movement is required to satisfy our demands. So the supply chain issue, of course, isn't just about lorries. It's about labor shortages we're seeing across the board in terms of production, cleaners, for example, food processors, factory workers, and so on. And product shortages, as OJ mentioned. Let's not forget that the factories of the world were essentially closed down for 6 months. And supply chains don't work by just turning the tap back on. There is a huge, huge backlog, and it's that backlog that we're trying to mitigate against at the moment. The costs of shipping have increased exponentially. If you look at the Baltic Dry Index, I believe that the cost of the containers that goods are transported in have increased like eight times in during the pandemic, and average delivery times of freight has reduced from half a day to 6.5 days in terms of delays. So there is a drip down effect and a trickle down effect, and I think I'm sure that others will mention this, but the big example was obviously the trouble that we had with the Suez Canal. That was just one ship that didn't turn the right way, and that was 2 months of backlog. So there's plenty of issues in the supply chain at the moment, and I think that what a lot of people in the industry are realizing is that they need to be more resilient. And with things like COVID and pandemics, which you cannot plan for, and increasingly extreme weather, there's a lot of focus on trying to mitigate that long-term risk. So I guess finally, bringing it back around to how that's all going to affect retail in this country. I mean, the headwinds for retailers have been extraordinary in recent years, and they've only really got worse in the past 18 months or so. As OJ said, this is the golden quarter. I think starting with, there are some positives, I believe, because if you look at retail, overall retail spend has increased on the whole. Anecdotally, and according to many polls that you see, it looks like a lot of people have got their Christmas shopping done early in anticipation for, this potential supply chain issue that we're in. And before the variant came along to disrupt us all a bit, consumer confidence was quite high. And remember, people lost a lot of family time, lost a lot of spending time and doing things they liked to do last Christmas. People want to re-engage and re-immerse themselves in traditions that we all love. But retailers are, and indeed the hospitality sector, and I'm sure that Andrew and David will be able to talk about this in much more depth than I will, but the costs associated with opening premises are through the roof, and revenue looks like it may well decrease, unfortunately, just when they need it most. So there's a lot to churn through, and hopefully, I think I might leave it there because I could end up reading the Magnus Opus. So,
yeah. James, that's great. Actually, some fascinating statistics. One that I'm definitely going to use about the extra lorries. We all talk about climate change and the challenges, and then you quite rightly, as we look at the switch in terms of the way we do our lives, notice that, and the requirement for extra lorries. Andrew, good morning. Andrew Goodacre, who is the CEO of the British Independent Retailers Association, is going to address us next. Andrew, good morning, welcome, and hello.
Yeah, good morning, everyone, and thank you for the invite to this meeting today. So I think I'll talk about some of the supply chain problems retailers face. I mean, I represent independent retailers in the UK, so they're much more smaller and in many ways agile, and I'll reference that as well. And also point out some of the solutions, I guess, retailers have found in order to meet some of these challenges head on, really. So I think, as James has said, you know, supply chain issues are well documented, well known, well reported on. And the real challenge is, I guess, it's a very long supply chain that we have because we import so much more than we export or manufacture within the UK. And when you're looking at the supply chain, whether it's the cost of shipping, whether it's the containers being in the wrong place, whether it's the ships not being able to get into port, whether it's manufacturing factories being closed down because of COVID in China, or even ports being closed down because of COVID in China, there's no one way of solving it. You know, if you suddenly recruited the number of lorry drivers that we need in the UK, you would still face certain issues coming along because of the length of that supply chain and the various factors that are at play that we can't control. But what we can control, I guess, is once the goods have arrived in the UK, is then moving it from port to store. And that's where the lorry driver aspect has been highlighted. I think the government has tried to ease. I don't think the visa scheme was ever going to work, in fairness. I'm about to say it's almost a token gesture, I guess, but what they have done better is fast track people through, and hopefully that will come through. The terms and conditions of drivers, certainly pay-wise, I read yesterday that it's over £53,000, I think. I think that's Tesco's paying them, Marks and Spencer's, I think, are paying that, and more for lorry drivers than in many of their head office roles. So there has been a shift in recognition of the importance of logistics. There's still work to be done. I think the whole infrastructure around HGV freight removal around the UK needs changing. Truck stops need investing in. We need to take ownership of that and make that happen. Otherwise, those people who are joining lorry driving will quickly depart it as well. So we do need to improve the whole environment in which lorry drivers work in that respect. What some of the larger retailers have done to mitigate the challenge of the lack of drivers is to turn to rail freight. And I think there's been an increase in rail freight. A lot of the major ports have direct links on rail out to the major cities. And the likes of Tesco's have certainly been choosing to put on rail because one goods train or freight train is equivalent to 70 or 80 lorries a time. So it does make sense where possible for that to happen. But again, longer term, that will need huge investment because I heard yesterday from the Ports Association that it takes 10 hours for a goods train to move from Liverpool to Birmingham. And so you have to factor that in because priority is given to people trains effectively or commuter trains. So it's an element that I think will grow in the future and make that happen. The impact on the high street is, I think, hats off to retailers of all sizes, because yes, there have been gaps. I'm sure customers have noticed gaps. There's probably less choice in some cases, but there's been a huge effort from retailers of all sorts to get product into their shops. And that will continue all the way through this festive period. And that, you know, for the large retailers, they have a very rigid supply chain. It goes through the large distribution centres and out from there to their various network of shops. And they've had challenges all the way through, whether it's ports, whether it's lorry drivers, whether it's people working in distribution centres, to the point of getting it offloaded into the shops as well. So huge effort, and that will continue. And I think, the shoppers, importantly, the consumers will not have a Christmas spoil because of that. At our level, in the small to medium enterprise retailers, they have a much more agile distribution chain. They're not locked into contracted suppliers. They have nominated suppliers, best suppliers, but if they can't meet their needs, then they are quickly moving to other sources for similar type products. They use wholesalers as well, and if the wholesaler can't deliver, the retailer will go and collect. Excuse me, my dog's just seen the postman, I think. So at the local level, it's certainly been a challenge for retailers. They've had to readjust and make changes, make product substitutions. But again, they're out there meeting the needs. the scale of the problem, we did a snap survey of our members, 96% of our members have suffered retail supply chain issues over the last 3 months. But it's no one particular category, it's no one particular product. We cover everything from a small pet shop to an independent department store, and they've all suffered in some way, shape or form. The biggest challenge I think they've got for the festive period, which as everyone has highlighted is the most important period for retail, has been twofold. One is, have they had the ability to order in advance? And if some of these businesses have been more cash rich and got cash in reserves, they've been able to order in advance and take the orders a bit earlier and stockpile that order. And I think those who've been able to do that have seen a benefit from that. If you're not able to do that, then you're really looking to rely on stock replenishment. And this will be the downside that we'll see from a business point of view, because stock replenishment is not going to happen this year. So whatever festive period stock they got in, whether it's toys, whether it's presents, whether it's gifts, whether it's Christmas lights, the whole range of that, whatever the shops have got in now is likely to be, and certainly at the independent level, all they've got. And replenishing that stock will be incredibly difficult because the supply chain, the range of product, the amount of product just isn't there possibly. And we've seen evidence of even sort of goods. There is a risk that some of the orders that for the festive stock may arrive late, and that will be a problem. We saw that earlier this year. I think we've seen reported garden furniture arriving in one of the ports in October, November that should have been there in March, April. And I'm fairly certain that we'll hear stories of Christmas trees having been ordered that will be arriving late as well. So the risk to the retailer on the high street, large and small, is yes, they're meeting, they're filling shelves. Yes, they're doing their best to get stock there, but it's the lost opportunity of extra sales. You know, if there's the demand for certain lines, but they can't replenish that stock, they can't replace it, then the shoppers go elsewhere if they can find it or end up online. And so from a retail point of view, it could have been in an even better period. That's really hard to measure. It's really hard to assess. But I suspect there'll be elements of that coming through. It's always hard at Christmas to get your stock ordering right anyway, because you can never anticipate which lines will be particularly popular, especially in the toy world in that respect. But I fear that they'll have a good Christmas, or we're looking to have a good Christmas, and I think Omicron will affect that. But it could have been even better if the supply chain was working as smoothly as we've become to expect. And maybe that's part of the problem. We've taken for granted that logistical challenge and the skill involved with moving freight around in this country. We've taken it for granted. And as soon as there's a big bump in it, something that we didn't anticipate, hopefully now we begin to appreciate what's required to avoid such disruption in the future. And I'm sure that there'll be plans with logistics companies, with large retailers, and even the smaller guys to sort of think to themselves, well, how do I minimise a risk in the future from that point of view? But hopefully we'll have had enough stock to have enjoyed a strong festive period.
Andrew, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to go straight to David. David Sheen, who's the Public Affairs Director of UK Hospitality. David, good morning. Welcome. And we're looking forward to your words of wisdom.
Good morning, Stephen. And thanks for the invite to yourself and to OJ. I will try to avoid duplication. Yeah, I completely agree with what Andrew and said in different parts of their words so far. I think probably just touch. I'll focus on labour shortages, but probably just touch on Omicron as word of the week. I think our view is that it's probably at the moment. There's no need to panic from the messaging we're getting from scientists and from government. I think we risk causing a crisis if parts of the media talk up the risks. We're already seeing some stories coming out. There's a story in the Times today around Christmas party cancellations, which could be devastating for the sector if that story catches fire and it sort of ends up instigating more cancellations. Speaking to members, trade's already down this week since the statement on Friday and Boris's press conference on Saturday. There's a noticeable drop down in revenue. to be fair to government, I think their messaging has been as strong as it can be. I think from a hospitality perspective, the no face coverings is a positive from our perspective. The messaging that this is a proportionate response and that people shouldn't be cancelling their Christmas parties, I think is the right one at the moment, given the sort of lack of evidence that this variant is any worse. But there's obviously nervousness throughout the sector, given that this is such a critical period for the sector. So I think that's probably where we are sort of in the up to Christmas. Bearing in mind, we surveyed members and felt they were about 11% down on where they'd normally be for Christmas bookings prior to last weekend. So that's quite a concern. In terms of labour market, clearly this is something that's affecting all sectors, but it's being felt particularly acutely in the hospitality sector. The latest ONS statistics had vacancies in the sector up 54% compared to the same period 2 years ago. So I feel like there's an absolutely seismic shift in the labour market, and particularly in the hospitality labour market, for many of the reasons that everyone will know, some I think predominantly driven by COVID, and then probably a little bit of Brexit overlaid on that. Our view is that Brexit isn't really the primary driver of that, but maybe sort of complementing COVID in terms of a lack of willingness potentially to come back from those who left during the pandemic. Our latest survey had vacancies at about 14%, which extrapolating would suggest around 340,000 job roles vacant in our sector, which is a substantial chunk of those who are currently unemployed. I think some of that is people being in the wrong places, but the jobs being in the wrong place for those people. But it does feel that it's something that should be solvable. There are still people out there who aren't working and who want to be working, but there just seems to be a particular mismatch at the moment. Asking members, their view was that the lack of staffing had led to a drop in revenue of around 17%, as they just simply can't fulfil the demand. If that goes into December, that lack of labour would equate to about £2 billion in lost revenue, notwithstanding any impact of Omicron on lost sales. All other things being equal. In terms of impact, we've got managers working front of house staff, front of house roles, 62% of members reporting that, 61% reporting staff working longer shifts, which kind of has a snowball effect in terms of those staff then going off sick and not wanting to be working in the sector. 52%, well, around half reported reduced trading hours, reduced trading days, and a reduced menu. So it's pretty stark and is actually clearly having an impact on the ability to deliver the hospitality trade. I think it's not all doom and gloom, and the sector's got a lot to do itself. We did have high vacancy rates previously. That there is and has been historically an image issue for some roles within the hospitality sector. So we've been working closely with BAES, who set up a hospitality sector council with sort of skills and jobs and careers as part of that, as a key part of that. The industry set up a skills board, a pan industry skills board with governmental involvement to improve recruitment, to improve retention across the sector. That only met in November, so it's certainly no short-term fix. We're considering, we're actively considering and almost on the verge of signing off an image campaign to promote job careers in hospitality, and I know that's something other sectors have looked at. We've worked very closely with DWP on Kickstart particularly, but in sort of an education piece across job centres to talk up the virtues of working in our sector and what the benefits can be to try and help get those unemployed and certainly long-term unemployed back into work and working within our sector. various other projects on sort of hard to reach groups, particularly sort of ex-prison, ex-prisoners, the homeless through various charities, and not so hard to reach, but the over 50s workers who have been identified as sort of one of the hardest hit out of the pandemic. So we've been working with DWP and Andy Briggs, the sort of, I'm not sure what the right term is, but the sort of older person's ambassador, work ambassador, to look at how we can, I'm sorry, I will definitely have got that term wrong, but you know what I mean. Look at how we can actually break down some of the barriers to those in the third quarter of their life coming back into the workplace and particularly into hospitality. So barriers in terms of their perception of the sector and barriers in terms of how hospitality roles work. So that we've got, it's quite an exciting project there, and we believe that could deliver some real tangible benefits. And sort of rebuilding apprenticeship schemes, which were clearly decimated during COVID. I'm going to do a one-upmanship on Andrew here. He reported 96% of members having seen supply chain disruption. We got 98. So pretty much the same, which is obviously a worrying number. And that sort of the main issues are product lines, higher costs, and non-fulfillment of orders, which I'm sure Andrew's members will be very, very familiar with. I think probably just to end this, I think the end point that we kind of see is quite significant inflation with reduced sales. I know government's very concerned, pretty concerned about inflation. Bank of England particularly concerned. The labour shortage are already converting into significant cost increases. Not necessarily a bad thing, you might say. And I'm not sure we're not overly concerned that people are getting higher wages. It will, in the longer term, we hope, turn into a reduction in labour shortages. But clearly, in the short term, there's going to be significant price inflation. That's obviously compounded by energy costs, which whilst only sort of 3% of 3% of typical hospitality costs, if they are going up 50 to 100%. That's wiping out a substantial amount of profit for the sector if there was any left after other price increases. Sorry, I've slightly bombarded with numbers, so I'll probably end there.
David, thank you. I guess that I'm going to take the chairman's prerogative and ask the first question, which is that if we're having this meeting in December the 1st or December the 2nd, 2022, can I ask James, Andrew, and you, David, is life going to be any different? Are we going to have to face that we have embedded supply chain and logistics problems that aren't going to go away very quickly, and that we're going to have to adjust business models to cope with that?
Yeah, I was... in a select committee yesterday with the International Trade Committee, looking at the supply chain, international supply chain. And there were sort of greater experts than me as panelists. And they were clear, this is from the Ports Association, Shipping Chambers of Shipping and Lloyd's First. And they were quite clear that the container issue, the number of ships required to move freight around, the reordering of I'm trying to get back to normality certainly set to continue in 22 and maybe even to 23. So I think businesses, large and small, will have to get used to a fairly disrupted supply chain. And I think that's why we are seeing already people think about train freight as alternatives in this country to move stuff around. And the cost of the shipping lines is unlikely to, it may fall a little bit, but those container costs that James mentioned, I think used to be £2,000 in 2019, yeah. Now up to £18,000, depending on where it's coming from. I don't think that will drop down back to £2,000 levels very quickly. You know, the shipping companies are reporting record profits this year. And in fairness, many years have reported losses, so maybe it's their time to have a share. So I think there will be a considerable time frame for business, and not just retail, because car manufacturers will be shouting about this as well, because we're all relying on just in time. There'll be considerable switch to alternatives if they can establish.
David?
Yeah, we've been doing some work with Bayes as part of the sort of recovery group with the sector council, and sort of we've been looking at a 6 month time window, and certainly don't see any let up in the future in the next 6 months. Will that last out to December next year? Half of me is saying hopefully not. It'll all settle down, but I think Andrew's probably more on the planet than I am on this.
David, I was really interested in your comment, in your remarks to us. You said, you know, you talked about the shift in the labour market, which we've all seen in the hospitality industry. You know, if I walk down Woodward and High Street, there's, you know, hiring for roles here. What I was intrigued by was your remark that Brexit may not be the primary cause, because for a lot of people, what they see is many of the people who used to fill those roles were European nationals who've left London. And I just wonder if you see them returning, or whether we're going to see a shift such that UK nationals are going to take those roles up. Otherwise, those roles are going to remain vacant for a while, aren't they?
Yeah, well, I think my comment particularly was that Brexit needs to be seen in the context of COVID. That those, sure. we don't know whether those people coming back is the answer in the short term. It doesn't look like there's an immediate prospect of those from Europe returning to those roles. I think there has been a noticeable uptick in the proportion of the hospitality labour force that is UK national, and clearly there's work to be done that we need to be doing to attract UK nationals into the sector. There's sort of some long-term structural issues where the pipeline into hospitality has sort of fallen away, and the sector perhaps hasn't done as much as it could to sort of rebuild those training routes into the sector and make the sector seem as attractive. And so with so much at the moment, I think it's a bit of a waiting game. I think probably looking towards next summer and seeing whether there is sort of a bit more of a return. With the number of people who applied for settled status,
yeah, it
was 1 million people. So those people still have the rights to work in the UK, whether they choose to exercise that, I suppose.
Yeah. James, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, you know, some really, really sage points there from both Andrew and David, and I completely agree. I think from a, you know, going back to the question, is it going to be resolved overnight? The answer is no, unfortunately not. There is a huge, huge backlog. The problem with that backlog is, as I think Andrew pointed out, by the time that goods arrive, they're probably not wanted or unsellable. So there is a longer term view on this that perhaps retailers will have to think about a bit more carefully about what it is that they are perhaps not selling, but ordering in order to put on the shop floor, so to speak. So I think one problem that I sort of touched on in the beginning was this, you know, this encroaching threat of online, which is here to stay. We've all got very comfortable and used to having everything we want all the time. And, you know, we're not going to see a reversal back to pre-internet times at all. But I think that a certain, you know, we need to really think about, you know, how bad this is in terms of empty shelves. I mean, supermarkets aren't empty by any stretch of the imagination. There are shortages of some certain things. So there's a psychological aspect, certainly from a consumer side, to this as well. And thinking more long-term about what we can do about this, I mean, HGV issue, I mean, I read recently that it might take around 2 years to upskill enough British workers to replace those that those European ones that didn't return, decided not to return. So, you know, that's not going to change overnight. And then there's this this other thing, I'm not sure if I mentioned it in my opening skit, but you know, the potential repatriation of supply chains, which has been talked about quite a lot. And that's, again, that's not a simple fix. It's not a plaster on an issue either. So I think that, unfortunately, the long and short of it, no, but I think that hopefully we'll begin to evolve better strategies to cope with what we're seeing.
Yeah, thank you. I know that we've got Laura McCormick on the call from the Booksellers Association. Laura, good morning. I wonder if you just wanted to add anything in from the retail perspective and what your members are seeing.
Morning. I think it's quite interesting listening to all the different perspectives on this, especially around staffing, because from our members in store, getting like shop floor staff doesn't seem to be an issue at all at the moment. And I'm just wondering if that's part of people sort of rethinking how they want their lives to be post-COVID, and perhaps bookshops are lucky enough to have been hoovering up some of the people that don't want to return to 9-to-5 office environments, and that see bookshops as quite a nice way to spend a couple of years before their retirement. That being said, the warehouses and the rest of the supply chain are seeing the same issues that everyone else has been talking about. I think regarding shortages in the supply chain more widely, our members are very similar to Andrew's in a lot of ways. Lots of independents who have been trying to be as organised as possible in the run-up. However, like Andrew was saying, with toys, you never know what the big sellers are going to be. There's always a surprise book, I think, in the Christmas trading period that people just don't know is going to make the bestseller list. So there's a real fear, and there's been reports of large online retailers just swooping in and buying up entire print runs of those big sellers, leaving the bricks and mortar shops behind. I think books are quite lucky. A lot of them are printed in the UK. It's a relatively localised supply chain. So we've not had the sort of Suez Canal issues and Chinese shipping costs impacting as much as some other sectors. Although we have seen it, children's books and a lot of colour printing do come from that part of the world. So if you're buying any books for children, grandchildren, nephews and nieces, I suggest you get to your bookshop sooner rather than later, just in case there are any issues further down the line. I think it's interesting as well hearing about the issues around lorry drivers. A lot of bookshops receive their deliveries through quite light scoot vehicles. And I think there is a real danger that with everyone upskilling and retraining to drive HGVs, it could just transfer the problem elsewhere, and you'll have those smaller businesses that currently have LGVs delivering everything, then not having the drivers. And I think as well, what Andrew was saying around inflation and costs in retail, I think we're hearing that paper costs are up around 25%. It's not going to impact this Christmas, but certainly going into next year. There's no way that publishers and printers will be able to absorb that level of increase. So we'll definitely see the prices of books going up, which isn't necessarily a bad thing if wages are also increasing and people can keep up with it, but it's definitely something we're keeping an eye on. So that's a bit of a whistle stop tour of where bookshops are at the minute.
No, thank you. Thank you. Right, I'm going to open it up to general discussion. You can either put your name in the chat function, or you can just put your hand up on the usual way. Rob Holder, Rob, do you want to ask a question?
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
So thank you. Some really insightful information being shared there, and my immediate thoughts go to, we're clearly in the eye of the storm at the moment, as we're in the golden quarter. So I'm now thinking about Q1, Q2 next year in terms of the level of support needed for the sectors that we're talking about. And, you know, potentially Q1, Q2, more harmful, more damage as a result of support in those sectors being phased out. So just be interested to kind of get the panel's views on that. Because we clearly know what's ahead, Whereas, you know, a couple of years back when we first entered the pandemic, you know, we didn't really know, and we had to react really quickly. You know, we're clearly well informed about what we're facing into. And I just wonder, yeah, what support is needed? Thank you.
James, do you want to start with that one, please?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Rob. That's a really good question. I think, you know, it's actually quite hard to answer with any certainty, as with, you know, most things are these days, to be honest. From my lens, what COVID has done has really changed our relationship with our built environments completely. So, you know, if you cast your mind back a couple of years, we were all talking about the death of the high street and the death of retail, and then all of a sudden it was the death of the office. So what we're going to see over the next few years, and in reference to your point about vacancy rates especially, is hopefully a recalibration of places. And I don't know, you know, OJ's done some fantastic work on this in the past as well, and I've worked with him before. It's not easy, and I'm not saying it is, it's very, very difficult, but when you kind of, you know, laser out of the COVID issues, once hopefully, touch wood, you know, we do move past those, whether it's next year or the year beyond, that those wholesale changes will come organically. But in terms of support from whether that's government or elsewhere, I'm not entirely too sure. And I'm sure that the other experts on the panel will be able to talk a bit more about what that actually might be or might look like.
Andrew or David, do you want to chip in?
I think at some point we have to accept that businesses have to stand on their own 2 feet. So there've been lots of good schemes to support through the pandemic, and the pandemic isn't over, and there's still aspects of it that quickly can fluctuate. You know, the threat of a new variant, we've seen the reaction that David mentioned, and I think we'll probably see reduced footfall on the high street if you measure these figures this week as well. We have a concern about a cumulative cost effect impacting businesses next year. We know national minimum wage and national insurance contributions are going up, and that's probably going to have a 6-7% increase on labour costs. Energy, members are telling us that there's at least a twofold, if not threefold, increase in their energy costs. You know, and this is examples that we've been given, you know, a small shop from £3,000 a year to £10,000 a year, a medium-sized shop from 8 to over 20. So those are real costs that are going to come through into the business. And I guess one of the conundrums, one of the challenges for the government is how does it address the energy aspect? Because there's a cap on consumer energy costs, so that your suppliers are facing high import costs of energy and will therefore need to look at business as a means of balancing their books. But if business is exploited too much in that respect, then business will suffer as well. And the harsh reality is, you know, people don't go into dark, cold shops. So there is an element of control needed in there, I think, that the government may need to address. They've done good work in terms of business rates and with a retail discount that will also attract or encompass many, many more of the small, medium-sized retailers. Doesn't help the large guys, in fairness. Doesn't help the big businesses at all in that respect. But our membership and the wider small retailer market will benefit from that. Of course, we must remember that although it's a 50% discount, it does mean that businesses will pay twice as much rates next year than they have done this year. So in real terms, there's an increase. And again, it's can the business sustain that? So I think we need to be very wary of burning businesses with too much cost in that first half year, because we know that the consumer confidence is challenged. We know January, February is always a risky time for retail because it's once you get the January sales out, it generally falls off with the winter season, and we look forward then to March and the relifting of retail and with Easter, really. So if we can get through to that period without any more cost burden coming through, then that will be much, much appreciated.
Yeah, I'd echo pretty much all of that. I, we're very, very nervous about January, February. And then when you're starting to get the Easter early summer pickup, that's when your cost increases hit. Certainly for we've got a mix of members, some who will be receiving the full 50% discount, some who will be receiving virtually nothing because they are very large businesses, so they'll be tens of thousands of pubs, restaurants paying full rates effectively from April, which is going to be quite a significant hit to take. We're also in the fortunate position of having a reduced rate of VAT as it stands at 12.5% for hospitality and tourism, with the exception of alcoholic beverages. So that is due to go back up to 20% in April. That is going to wipe out significant margins if those margins exist. So we will obviously be calling on government to act to extend that reduced rate. And actually, whilst it was brought in as a temporary measure, all it really did was bring us into line with Europe with most European countries anyway. We were a significant outlier with a full rate. So we'll be calling for that to be extended to support the sector. I think James mentioned rent earlier, the rent moratorium ends at the end of March. We're very supportive actually of what the government's introducing in terms of an arbitration process, but there is a lot of rent debt hanging around that will need to be serviced, and that's going to be yet another drag on the sector and its sort of recovery plan. So want to be optimistic for next year, want COVID to have disappeared, want us to be back off our feet and investing in high streets and communities. But I think it's going to be really, really challenging with extra costs coming through.
Yeah. I think Mr. Chair, if I may say, I think we very much look at that short term. Longer term, we applaud the investment in infrastructure that was announced in the budget. We applaud the investment in town centres that's been announced and committed and supported through there. But they're longer term projects. And I think to answer your second point about rebalancing, Rob, invariably there will be less shops, whether it's small or large. There will be less shops. There'll be less, but there'll be a move into different types of uses, service retailing. We've seen growth in those areas, even through the pandemic. So I think there'll be a rebalance of what the high street is used for. And OJ knows that there's been lots of good work done in that area. Whether that alone can address the kind of the imbalance in supply chain, I'm not sure. I think the supply chain imbalance is a far bigger issue than just the number of businesses that need supporting through it.
Well, look, thank you all very much. Time has beaten us this morning, so I'm very grateful to James, to David, to Andrew for their very insightful contributions, a number of which points I've got noted down, which I will be using in speeches in the near future. So I always think plagiarism is a fairly good form of flattery, so I hope you'll accept that. But thank you all very much indeed for joining us this morning, and thank you to everybody who's attended this morning. As you can see, I think there's a real need for this group to continue. So I will be letting people know our January, February, March dates in the near future. But although it's early in the month of December, can I wish you the very best for Christmas, and let us all hope that it's a prosperous new year, and we'll surprise ourselves by not having to have this discussion next year as well. Thank you all very much.